and welcome to this Life Solved Short. I'm Robin Montague, and in these videos we get to chat with University of Portsmouth researchers who are working to change our world for the better. If you thought The Fifth Element was just a sci-fi movie, I've got news for you. Today I'm meeting the University of Portsmouth physicist who thinks he's found the fifth form of matter. To fit with existing physical theories, this form would have to exist without interrupting the properties of existing forms such as liquid, gases, solids and plasmas. So what is it? Here to talk with me more about his possible eureka moment is Dr. Melvin Vopson. Melvin, it's great to meet you. Thank you for being here.
Hi, Robin. Thanks for having me.
So, Melvin, let's begin with the basics. I say basics. This is not going to be a basic discussion, but let's start from the beginning. What has it meant when people say the fifth element, and why is it something that physicists and scientists have been trying to look for?
So the short answer is the fifth element is more like a scientific metaphor. It's a term used to fill the gap of something that is either missing or we are not sure what it is. Specifically in my research, and what I think is the fifth element it goes back to a study published in 2019 reporting a equivalence principle between energy, mass and information. And in this study, I hypothesized the possibility that information itself is a form of matter and it might be the fifth element, possibly the missing bits in the universe, things like dark matter and other unknown components.
Now, there you mentioned dark matter. For anyone who isn't aware of the term dark matter, what does this actually mean when we're talking about space in the universe?
The entire universe is made up of three big things. About 5% of the universe is made of the ordinary matter, things that we can see, touch, and is experienced around us all the time. And then the majority of the universe, 95%, is made up about 68% of something called dark energy. And about 27% is made up of dark matter. Dark is another metaphor for things that we can't really see, we can't really detect. We don't know, we know they're there, but we don't know what they are. In my work, the information extrapolation has been made only in relation to dark matter. I'm not discussing anything about dark energy. That's a completely different ballgame. Dark matter is a necessity to explain the dynamics of galaxies. They move in a specific way that requires some additional extra mass to be there present in order for the dynamics of the galaxies to be explained. And this is something that we can see with ordinary telescopes. We know is there, we just can't see what is there and what it is.
So this theory that you're working on, this has been something that was theorized decades ago, or initially the concept came about into discussion. What sparked that? Why was it something that was suddenly thrown into the mix?
It was the emergence of digital technologies, digital computing, and information data storage, digital information data storage. So Landauer realized that a computing device or an information processing device or an information storage device, yes, it deals with digital states and information states, but it's a physical system that is part of the universe itself, is not isolated. And because of that, it has to obey the laws of physics. And we know from thermodynamics, for example, that an irreversible process dissipates heat. And he was the first to suggest that logical irreversibility, in other words, computing processes which are irreversible, should behave just like thermodynamic processes. So they should dissipate heat. And an example of a logical irreversible process is the erasure of a bit of information, of a memory state of information on a computing device or memory device. He worked out that being a dissipative process, it needs to dissipate some energy. So where is that energy coming from? And then he was the first to suggest that maybe the information itself carries some energy, it's a form of energy. My work was to extrapolate that to include mass in the equation, but this has been theorized in the 60s. And I'm pleased to tell you that there are very recent articles published in Nature and Science confirming experimentally Landauer's principle. This is no longer a theoretical principle. It has been confirmed experimentally. We know that a bit of information dissipates a specific amount of energy at erasure.
That's fascinating. I think for people like myself who struggle sometimes to wrap their head around the intricacies of physics, when you mention that the fifth form of matter could potentially be something that we, you know, we work with daily, it's part of our, you know, lives intrinsically, and yet we can't see it. And I still can't get my head around the fact of that being a form of matter. So when you say information, then what are we talking about? Is it just on, you know, technical devices, or does it go further than that?
It's a very good question, actually. So it's a highly complex question. How do you define information? And when we talk about information in the context of this research and the meaning of information in what I'm referring to, by information we mean a function, a mathematical function, which defines the amount of information in units of bits, for example, depending on the, I'm not going into the details, but it's a logarithmic function, and the base of that logarithmic function dictates the units. So we usually use bits because this is more common for us. But this is a mathematical function and is linked to the probability of an event to occur or not. The more probable an event is, the less information you need to resolve the uncertainty about the event, or the less information you can extract by observing the event. Maybe to give you an example, the Schrödinger cat, you know, the famous quantum mechanical thought experiment where a cat is placed in a box. The box has a poisonous material in there that will be released at a random time. The box it has no windows, no viewing points, and the cat is in there. Is the cat alive or dead at the time T? You would not know that unless you look at the box. But from an information point of view, you would have two possible states. So the probability is 50-50. And by observing the cat, okay, you extract one bit of information only, one bit of information, because there are only two possible states, either dead or alive. And is this probabilistic nature of everything around us, events around us and everything else, that generates the information? And this is measured in units of bits, to keep it in the framework of Shannon. Let's put it like this. But the beauty is everything can be reduced to this probabilistic thing, everything.
As you just said, this is nothing really just to do with the technical advancement of mankind. Obviously, that's led to the theory being developed earlier on in the last century. But information has been gathered and supposedly stored in the universe since the dawn of time. if I'm right in what you're saying, is that there's information out there that related to the beginning of the universe.
It's not just information being gathered or being created. And more recently, we are shaping up our own planet by generating incredible amounts of information. My 2020 article called Information Catastrophe deals with this specific problem. But there is inherent information in the universe itself. And what I mean by that is, if you look at laws of physics, for example, this is information. Are they written somewhere? We know there are laws of physics that make the universe function, and they are the same here or in a different galaxy or at the edge of the universe. They are absolutely uniform and the same. Particles, elementary particles, they are all behaving following a matrix, following a set of rules, if you want. And this is an idea that there is certainly some form of information, an underlayer to this observable universe that puts everything into motion, if you want, or organizes everything. In addition to that, we are also shaping up our own planet and our own society by developing these advanced technologies, digital technologies, artificial intelligence, computing technologies. All these things are they function on information, more specifically digital information. But there are other forms of information. It's all to do with this probabilistic nature of things.
So from the sounds of it, there's been a lot of advancement, particularly recently, in the research of this. Why has the scientific community been reluctant to, I suppose, back this theory previously?
I'm not sure they'd be reluctant. I thought I'm quite the odd one there, you know, but I had to do background literature reading and look at the literature. And I was amazed to see how many people have been looking at this and heavyweight scientists, you know, publishing this kind of stuff and, you know, working on these ideas. One name comes to my mind now is Professor Seth Lloyd from MIT. He published more than 10 years ago, I think, studies revolving around the idea of a computational universe. So in his view, who is a quantum mechanics physicist, in his view, the whole universe is a giant computer, and he thinks it computes itself. And a few other guys, for example, Nick Bostrom from Oxford University. He's not a physicist, but he's into philosophy and science. And he came up with the concept of simulation hypothesis, that the whole universe might be actually a simulation, not just a giant computer, but a simulation.
Matrix.
Exactly, yes. And these are just a few names, but it's a lot of a growing community out there that are looking seriously at the possibility that the information is more fundamental to everything than we think.
Really fascinating to chat with you today, Melvin. Thank you so much for joining me. If you want to delve into the full interview, go to the website where you can find links to listen to the LifeSolve podcast. You can click the link in the comments box below or head to port.ac.uk/research. See you again next time.